Wait. No footsteps knocking at your door. You're letting me breathe again. Keep coming back. I'm a slave for you, but this ain't like before.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for joining us this morning. We were talking about the future of design and architecture. These are beautiful panelists revealing themselves as we speak. As you know, my name is Sana, and I'm the organizer of the Design Pop-Up events. This series of virtual panels are sponsored by Domus Styles, which we are very much grateful for. This morning, we have with us a very talented group of people. And I'll start, as usual, this morning session with introducing each one of our panelists. Obviously, ladies first. So our first panelist is the amazing Nimi. She's the founder and director at NIM Team Architects. Nimi's background sees her experience matured in practices like Hawkins Brown's. Nimi is also a qualified garden and landscape designer, so she's got a double business. She's a very busy lady. She's also a member of the Design Southeast panel, which is a multidisciplinary panel of leading construction professionals that offers a clear, constructive, and consistent voice on design quality in the built environment. Also with us today is Nicholas Worley. Nicholas Worley is the associate partner at Fletcher Priest. He's been involved in some ginormous and beautiful projects all around, both in UK and internationally. One of these is Nicholas was the leader of a large team that completed the Angel Court development in London, among others. Nicholas is also a very, very, very talented photographer. And if you go and see his website, the photos are absolutely stunning. With us today also, we got Simon and the other Nicholas Shepaniak that have recently joined their forces together and founded the Shepaniak Astridge Studio. Before that, Simon Astridge was working with his own practice, and he is very passionate about sustainability and the social and cultural benefits that sustainability can have on human behavior. He is also the brain behind a stunning personal gallery in London that was shortlisted for IRBA awards. On the other hand, Nicholas Shepaniak is also involved in international projects. Is also he leads design workshops and in tutoring in universities like Bartlett, UCL and the University of Greenwich. And in the past, he's been working with Heather in the Heatherwick Studio and Michaelis Boyd Actors in London. Last but not least is Tom. If you read his profile, you stop and think, gosh, I really need to send my CV to Tom. Because Tom is very passionate about creating timeless projects that make clients' lives better. But most importantly, for him, it's very important that this team enjoys working in the studio. So he organizes a lot of frequent trips in restaurants, bars, and foreign excursions. I wonder what I need to do to get invited to the next one. Anyway, good morning to everybody. As usual, I've got a set of questions that we prepared for our speakers, but please feel free to ask as many questions as you like. We'll keep an eye on that and trying to make the session as interactive as possible. This morning, we'll be talking, as we said, about the future of design and architecture. But before talking about the future, we would like to balance a bit between the old technologies, old methods, and new ways of working. So maybe we could start with Tom, and we ask you, Tom, since you do a lot of digital sketching, computers and digital technology are now dominating the world, the way you guys work. Which one is the new technology that you think has revolutionized your everyday, the way you work every day? Hold on, I can't hear you anymore. I need to, no, you are, oh. Sorry, Tom, we can't hear you. What happened there? No.
Let me try this instead.
Oh, you go. You are with us. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Yeah, so something we do a lot of now is the digital sketching on the iPads. And I think for us, you know, the thing with technology is that if it breaks you away from the way you like to work, it's no good. But you know, we've always worked with pencil and sketch, and now we can do that. We can do that digitally, so it's actually much faster for us. And I think that's the perfect example of where technology is not forcing you to work in a different way. You know, we all want to work in the way that we feel the most creative, and I think now it's flexible enough when this technology appears that you can work in the way you want to work rather than the way that the computer wants you to work. I think that's crucially important.
Yes. So, Nick, you also are very passionate about new technologies and new ways to work. Have you got anything else to add to Tom's?
Well, I would echo the point. Well, in the current situation, I don't have a printer or a scanner here at home. So digital sketching, actually, in the current situation of working remotely, has been really, really useful. And I think I'll probably find it difficult to go back to a paper-based, less environmentally friendly method, I think. One of the things we're looking at in the office and pursuing quite strongly is using virtual reality with clients. I think there's a lot of potential in VR, and we've created a studio in the office dedicated to VR. Because it allows us to, I think more than anything, describe spatially how buildings feel. It's always been difficult, I think, to help or to describe to clients the feeling of volume or the generosity of volume through still images that are printed onto a two-dimensional piece of paper. But as soon as you put a headset on and look around a space and you feel that you're in there, you can help communicate ideas much more efficiently, I think, much more emotionally using VR. So we're really excited about where that might take us.
So bouncing back on old ways of working, Nicholas Szczepaniak, I've seen some of your drawings that are always absolutely stunning. So we know digital technologies are definitely helping, but how do you incorporate the handmade methods into the new design processes? And do you still work a lot with the hand drawing and stuff?
Yeah, I mean, I think for me personally, but as a practice, we're super interested in the hybrid of both kind of digital and analog technologies. So the hand drawing on a piece of sketch has very much a place in the studio as much as what producing a 3D model in the computer might do. And I think actually all of these things are, it's like really important to remember that ultimately these things are just tools. And it's thinking about what is the most appropriate tool for the task at hand. You know, so for us, you know, pen and paper, it's like a very quick way, a very intuitive way of thinking about ideas and testing something very quickly. Whereas the computer, it might allow you to explore it in a slightly more precise way. But also, I think it's about thinking about any practice, but particularly as a small practice, you know, what might be the most cost-efficient way as well, you know, whereas now, you know, creating a physical model, it might be quicker to put that through a digital fabrication process rather than actually hand-making it, which is actually now more, maybe more time-consuming. So, yeah, so in terms of like the drawings that we produce, it's often a hybrid of lots of different things, really.
And do you think your clients appreciate more your hand-drawn ideas rather than digital, or is it easier for clients to understand the visuals and your ideas through digital methods?
Yes, it's a super interesting question. And Simon and I were speaking about this just a moment ago. We got an email from a client this morning where it completely depends on the purpose of what you're trying to communicate. So we've got a client who's trying to sell some plots of a master plan at the moment, and you know, for them, like the super slick visual is the right communication tool for them. It's kind of what's accepted, you know, in the that particular market, the Southeast Asian market. You know, the sketch, you know, the idea of a hand drawing, it's probably less accessible for some of these people. So yeah, it completely depends on what you're trying to communicate and who you're trying to communicate to. So I think a lot of our task, a lot of the time, is really trying to understand those things, really, you know, making the right decision on what we're trying to communicate.
Nimi, you work in a slightly different market than the boys here. It's more residential. So do you notice a difference in that way?
Yeah, I think I agree with most of what's been said. I think we use technology as a tool just to convey the idea. So, and it's different ways for different clients depending on what they're used to seeing. We still do a lot. We love sort of working in different ways, hand drawing, modeling visually, creating kind of images to convey an idea. And it depends on who's running the project or what the project needs and how best to do that. I don't think clients need that super slick kind of visual. They want more of a kind of a feel. They want to kind of get an idea of how that space is going to make them feel and how it's going to change the way that they live. Whereas some work that we do for developers, I think they're right. I think they want more of a kind of a big image, a kind of a selling image that's gonna, you know, the whole scheme will pivot off of. But we often love making models as well, and find that clients really respond well to that, just to mm-hmm. get an understanding of the space and the site and the context and how it sits within it. So yeah, we just use different ways, but it depends on the client, I think, and what they're going to respond to.
Have you got a favorite method?
We love hand drawing and models, really. We use SketchUp a lot of the time to help us produce those images. So we kind of have a mix between the digital and the hand drawing. But we love sketching. We love paper and pens. It's difficult. I mean, some people have kind of, they can work faster sketching digitally than they can with a pen and paper. And it just kind of depends who's doing what. But for me personally, it would be sketching with a pen and paper.
And Nick, you work on major international commercial projects. Have you got a favorite? Sorry, you're muted. Hold on.
Sorry. Pen and paper is the same, or digital sketching, hand sketching, paper and pen sketching. There's no better way, I think, to describe an idea quickly than to sketch it. And I can't imagine that will ever be bettered.
No, good. So moving on, materials and the way the materials work together. Architecture has evolved alongside building materials, obviously, as a must have. As materials become more sophisticated, so does architecture. What's the most exciting futuristic material you've seen that's used by architects at the moment? Tom?
I think we're potentially at the opposite end of this question, in the fact that we go with quite classic materials, and it's all about longevity in some ways, because we're not necessarily we don't necessarily want our clients to be the guinea pigs, but also I think it's a case of how you use some of the older materials. And we really, you know, our choice of material always comes down to primarily two things: that it's driven by the context. And it's driven by longevity, and really how we can, you know, how the building can really stand the test of time. I think this is such an important thing, and in some ways, material innovation needs to be careful about that because buildings are there for a very long time, and so you actually need something that not only will it last from a physical standpoint, but how does it last aesthetically to sit in its context?
Yeah, and obviously we always need to remember that materials need to keep people safe. So
yeah,
Simon,
absolutely.
What do you think, Simon? I've seen you using a lot of different materials, and is there anything that is coming up? And also with this coronavirus problems, everybody start talking about antibacteria and surface that needs clean easier, stuff like that. What's your point of view on this matter?
Yeah, so I don't know. We try to not like follow trends or seeing what's the new material coming up. It's more trying to authentically like specify it for the job, and the client and the budget, and then, you know, and not architects do get to sort of gravitate towards like certain nice materials and textures, and, you know, light is a material, for instance. And I mean, going to the second part of your question, we've definitely noticed during lockdown, post-COVID, working with clients that, you know, they want bigger amenity, bigger gardens, they want more fresh air, they want home gyms, home offices, they want to be more segregated from their neighbours, you know, and offices are going to want the same as well. And we're noticing it on the job we're doing in Cambodia. The master plan's getting less and less dense every week. You know, you look back to 10 years ago, you'd say to a developer, you know, half the amount of units in your project. That'd be crazy. But now I think the market was moving that way and has been sped up to move that way. And I think it will continue to do that. And you'll find cities perhaps become slightly less dense and bigger amenity and more terraces. And, you know, I do think it's moving in the right direction.
Nick, are you any more adventurous with your material choices, trying to go for the new innovation?
No, sorry. We stick to the classics too, and we look at how best they might be appropriated and used and finished. To be honest, me on a personal level, I'm really interested in self-finishing materials, so those that you don't need to layer with lots and lots of stuff and scupper the embodied carbon that a project might entail. And of course, on very large projects, it's important on every single project, every square meter of finish or surface is important. But when we're looking at the big projects, we have to be very careful about which materials we specify.
Okay. Simon, back to you. How much do aesthetics play a part in decision-making with regards to materials? In a world so focused on sustainability and carbon reduction, since you are our sustainability expert today, does sustainability mean we need to compromise on aesthetics?
No, I don't think it should. I think it should be the opposite way. You should embrace it and accept that. Well, we're working on a concept at the moment in the South Downs National Park, and we want to build a house from what's beneath people's feet. You know, literally, we want to dig up the earth, and we want to make round earth walls. And as Nick was saying, you know, just leave it. You know, why does it need all these other layers? Why does it need plastering? Why does it need painting, ceiling, etc.? So I think sustainability, obviously, it's banding around as a word. Everyone's using it, but it's all about that sort of joined up thinking of that circular economy, as Nick was alluding to. You know, how many if you dig foundations for a house, how many trucks have got to get rid of that earth, and what's their carbon footprint? Can that earth be used on the site? And it's really about, and clients are starting to embrace that really. It's going to become part of the norm. You know, to be off grid, to sell electricity back to the grid at certain times of the year, you know, is what actually clients want, and they're approaching us with those briefs now.
We got a question from the audience that is right on perfect timing for you, Simon. How does carbon neutrality play in your design? Are clients starting to talk about it and ask for it? Is the coronavirus going to increase urban spread?
Yeah. Absolutely, it's so relevant, isn't it? Like, it's all becoming funneled into this bottleneck as we speak, and everyone's got to start reacting. We are reacting, and like everyone else, we're figuring it out. But you know, an example is with Nicholas and I are working on a project, a mixed-use project in Brixton. And Brixton, South London, is quite famous for its food markets, and there's quite a lot of waste. You know, I live in the area, and there's a lot of food waste on the streets and everything after all these markets are finished every day. So we're using a project where we can collect it in this mechanical device. We can go around cycling, collect all the waste, and we put it into a machine, and at the other end it generates electricity, so we can power our building with it. And then we use that power to grow vegetables and fruit, and then we sell that back to the market, and it's that continuous cycle. So it's that kind of joined up thinking that I think architects can bring to projects.
That's amazing. Also makes the street smell better if you recycle the rubbish.
It do smell bad at the moment, yeah. So.
Yeah. Nimi, I've seen one of your projects. You used the beautiful cork walls, and there was beautiful pink windows. So you bring some touch of color in this conversation today. So what you're thinking about material sustainability, integration and trends?
I guess we kind of look at each project on its own basis, what it needs, or what the clients are interested, what the context needs. And like some of the others said, for us, it's about longevity. So it's about building something that's going to last, so it meets our clients' needs now and in the future. And we tend to look at actually a lot of old materials or materials that are already existing and just think of different ways of using them. A lot of our projects are built on quite tight budgets. So it's also about thinking about maybe materials that you wouldn't expect to find in that context, but maybe it could work and still create a kind of architecture that's interesting and meets the client's brief. With Cork House, we spent a lot of time trying to find a material that had a texture, but was had sort of good environmental sustainable properties to it. The clients were quite interested in that, and they were up for making a kind of bold and unusual choice. We kind of bring the clients into the decision making, so it doesn't feel like we're suggesting this material for them. It's about us finding the right material together. And then they feel kind of invested in it, and they then kind of feel empowered to kind of make bold choices like pink windows and things.
Tom, what's your usual decision-making process when selecting materials to use in a project? As Nimi said, obviously it must be a conversation with your client and a joint decision, or how do you devise the final material palette?
I think, like I was saying earlier, it's really, it's a conversation with the client, but it's highly context driven. And, you know, a lot of our work is in London, some work in the country, some work in a project in Italy. And so in all these different places, you're going to use different materials. And even the variation around London is incredible, really, when you do different projects in different boroughs. So context is a massive part, and then it's the question of is the design highly contextual and made to kind of fit, or should it be contrasting? And that the choice there really comes down to discussion with the client. But even even when you contrast, it has to actually work with the context. So. At an aesthetic level, that's where the thinking comes from. But as the others are saying as well, it's highly driven by doing something that once we complete the project, it will be there to last for a very long time. I mean, I think that is, you know, we all keep saying this, that inherently sustainable choices are not buildings or, you know, whatever we do to a building, if it's just there for 20 years it comes down again, this is not a sustainable you know, it doesn't matter how sustainable material you've used, unless it's well designed, it serves the right purpose for the owners, and it fits in with its context. Then I think it has a chance of staying there for a very long time. You know, we have an awful lot of highly long term sustainable brick terraces all over London, partly because they've been there for so long. It's not a good insulator, and it has other problems. But in terms of its embodied carbon, it's been fantastic. So. We start and those sort of thinking.
Nick, you're involved in slightly different projects than Tom and Nimi. Have you got anything to add to this thoughts?
To be honest, I think there are some fundamental architectural principles that we're talking about here that apply at any scale. So I wouldn't really comment any differently.
So let's go on, move on to the next question. Anish Kapoor, Nick, let's stay with you. Anish Kapoor famously patented the high-tech paint Vanta Black that usually absorbs 99% of light. Is there a finished material or covering that does not currently exist that you would like to create and use in your project?
There is, but I'm not going to tell anybody about it, otherwise you're going to run off with the idea. I would love a carbon negative, fireproof material that performs better than concrete or steel and is lightweight enough to move by hand and beautiful to look at and touch, you know, wouldn't they? The sort of holy grail. To be perfectly honest, I don't sort of sit and think, oh, is there a material that I would love to use or create? That's not really how we work and where I'm at personally. I use what's available. And as I say, I have a very sort of responsible approach to the materials that we source and we use.
Nicholas, any same thoughts as Nick, or have you got different ideas?
Yeah, I mean, similar to Nick in a way. I mean, we've got like a bit of an ongoing experimental project in the office where it's not necessarily literally a material that we'd like to use on a building. I mean, it's very experimental, where we're using sugar in terms of in its caramel form, and using that to kind of create these kind of glass-like curtains. And it's been something that we've been working on for 5 years. And like I say, it's not necessarily a material that we want to use as a literal building material, but I think perhaps it does have quite interesting properties that could be like characteristics of an architecture in the future. So it's it's very interesting in that it's hygroscopic, so it absorbs moisture in the air. So it's like this material that is responsive to the climate and the environment. It's very lightweight, it's deployable, it has like this beautiful transparency to it. So it has all these characteristics that are that we find very interesting. And so we kind of tend to work in that way, really.
I've got another question from the audience now. So maybe let's go back to Nick. Simon earlier on was talking about how already how the clients are asking for different things in light of the coronavirus situation. This one of our attendees is asking, do you feel that post-COVID architects will have to adapt to the new normal and find a new way of working and designing safer spaces that will be physically safer as well as creating a mentally safe space?
The basic answer is yes. To give a bit of context, I guess, I'm mostly involved in the sort of workplace sector at large scale, big office buildings, if you like, that are going to undergo quite a change post-COVID. But much of what happens in office buildings, big office buildings, is often determined by the funders, the guys that pay for these projects. And we're now finding that there are many, many big organizations, big tenant organizations like the big tech guys, Google, Microsoft, and Apple have just recently committed to being carbon neutral throughout their whole supply chain by 2030. So that means anybody that these guys will engage with need to be carbon neutral. And these big tenants who really drive the sort of sea of change in workplace are going to influence which types of offices let. So only offices that are very, very environmentally responsible are going to let, but also those that provide environments that people want to work in. I think we've all found that working from home is possible. It's probably not as advantageous, certainly in the design process for us personally. There's nothing like being around a table in a meeting to sketch and discuss ideas, but we need a way to get people back into offices comfortably and for people to want to go back to the office. For me personally, I think that's going to be very much driven by the sort of experience-based offer and the amenity offer that buildings have. I think Simon was talking earlier about the reduction in density. That's going to be a change. Offices can be much less dense. Historically, we've crammed more and more people into the same amount of space and given bits of amenity to sort of address that density. But the feeling is, from my perspective, that that's now going to relax again and ease a little bit. And buildings are going to have more amenity in them. And it could be more about an experience and not just your, you know, 9-to-5 workday.
Nimi, this leads us to perfectly into Patrick's question. Patrick is asking, how do the panelists work in collaboration with others digitally, and do they miss the round the table markup session? Nick has already said that he misses a lot. Yeah. What digital tools do they use to replace the round table meetings?
We found actually working through Zoom in the lockdown was okay. It wasn't too bad. But the one thing that we did find really difficult was designing. And we like to design together. And we just found the process took longer doing it remotely. There's a huge amount of tools now that you can use. Zoom is very intuitive. You can do markups on drawings. You can share screens. You can share markups. You can share, you can share the mouse direction and things like that, but we did find that actually it was quite difficult, because part of what NIMTIM is about the people that are in it, and sort of it's not just our design, it's sort of the studio's design, so everybody is involved. In some ways it worked quite well, because we could have design reviews and have everybody kind of there attending virtually, whereas sometimes it's hard to find time because everyone's busy going to sites, meeting clients, doing meetings in and out of the office. But yeah, I think it was tricky, and we sort of much prefer now being able to do small roundtable meetings now that we can, just for the design, just for the creativity part of our process.
Very good. Maybe let's go back to Tom with our next question. Since you've been talking about making buildings that last for a long time, when it comes to designing buildings and interiors, how much emphasis do you place on looking at the wider world and what's happening in it as part of your design process, or do you design purely based on aesthetics?
I guess aesthetics is a big issue, but you're always looking at the at the wider world, because it's far from. Aesthetics is one part of it, but if you're talking about materials, but the materials do form the materials form the project and the enclosure that we're making. So, and the whole project is absolutely tied in with, much wider, far wider issues than purely aesthetics. The fundamental thing is that it improves the client's, life from at a day-to-day level and a long-term level. Aesthetics does that, but actually we're looking to make a practical improvement to their life. We're actually looking to put a smile on people's face every day, and they can, be somewhere or look at something that they think, we've been part of making a really beautiful. But you come back and we use the word beautiful, but we don't use that purely in the aesthetic sense. Yeah, but a beautiful experience is not just an aesthetic one. A beautiful experience is one that actually makes you feel good. Yeah, you can have a beautiful experience in a way that is aesthetic. It's about the feeling. That's what the project gives you.
Yeah. Nicholas, I've seen some of your projects. One of the houses you designed for one of your clients, it was a kind of an addition to an existing building. So again, it's when you're thinking about your design process, how much do you take in consideration of what's there already and what's happening around the world? Or again, as we asked Tom, do you also focus more on aesthetics?
Yeah, I think aesthetics are obviously very important. We're all designers, and we all have sensibilities towards particular things that we like to look at. But like echoing what Tom was saying, there's so many different layers to what we do, and so many considerations that need to be made. It can't be just about aesthetics. It has to be, it has to be about considering somebody's lifestyle that they want to live. The budget consideration, program considerations. I think generally across all of our projects, we always undertake like quite an in-depth kind of research at the beginning of any project. And it's a lot of the time ideas come from making observations about particular things that we might have seen, in other references or a particular place that we've been, an art installation that we might have been inspired by. It's kind of wrong just to say it's just about aesthetics. It's very much about a layered approach of many different aspects that you need to consider. And actually, the best projects are the ones where all of these things are interrelated and all connected, it's like a kind of an equilibrium in a way where everything's kind of working together.
Simon, I've got a big word for you: Zeitgeist. So, if architecture offers a representation of society and culture, in what ways do you think architecture and design created in recent years reflects the current zeitgeist? If I pronounce that properly, I'm not entirely sure. Which recent architectural trends do you believe are a flash in the pan, and which are more enduring, and why?
It's a big question.
Yeah, big question.
Zeitgeist is in like the spirit of the age, the current trends, right? I've got that right, I think.
Yeah.
Trends, yeah, I mean, they do exist, because we see them, designers look at materials and colours come and go, like pinks were around a while ago, and marbles and, finishes, and we try not to follow trends. Like, okay, we've got to now do a terrazzo tile because terrazzo is a thing. It's more going back to what these guys are saying. You know, it is about the end user, the budget, the context, and the project is the most important thing for us. Yeah, the people are the most important thing. You know, because they're using the buildings. That you know, is architecture without people using it? You know, otherwise it is just an aesthetic thing. But if there's no people using the building, is it architecture? Well, I don't think so. I mean, you've got to be able to say humans are comfortable using this space or this bathroom or enjoy the light in this gallery. And then if that happens, then it's successful. And then that will ultimately kick off trends because it's a successful, beautiful building and it's been enjoyed by humans. And I think we try and have that view of trends. Just to answer the brief authentically and make architecture without trying to pay too much attention to trends is what I think.
Nimi, have you got any more thoughts on this matter?
Yeah, I think we agree as well. We don't tend to follow trends either. It sort of happens. I mean, I think things happen in the world that affect our thinking. You know, I think there's a strong feeling now towards a connection with nature and this inside and outside, and that filters through into our design work because ultimately that's what people want. I think that we try to design, like Simon was saying, a project that is for the people that are going to use it. And if we can create something that is, you know, meeting their brief now and in the future, then I feel like it's a success. Whatever materials, whatever the aesthetic is, if it's met their needs, then we feel really happy. I think we try to make things a lot. We're finding now people want sort of architecture that's flexible or adaptable or you know, meets their kind of individual needs. Like they've got rabbits or they love climbing, so they want a climbing wall. It can be completely crazy, but it's about, ultimately it's about them and what they want.
Nick, next question for you. How do you think the current chaos of international politics and societal disruption caused the global pandemic may affect architecture and design over the coming years? Do you envisage any overarching design trends arising as a result of the chaos?
Yeah, I think this probably goes back to what I was saying earlier. And if there's, I guess, one word that underlines it from my perspective, it's generosity. It's about spaces becoming more generous. I think there is a nervousness now about packing people into places so tightly, and the more generous we make spaces, the more successful they're going to be. We've tried to pursue adding generosity for a long, long time to all of our projects, and of course at the sort of the speculative developer end of the scale, there's always the desire for more area. So trying to help people understand the value of volume, sort of per individual, if you like, is really tricky. There were some trends towards experience-based workplaces previously, and Google sort of led the way with that. They're famous for their sort of playful amenity and free food. That was all about keeping people on site and talking about work for, you know, more than just the 8 hours of the day. And supporting the sort of mixture between the working day and your social life. The more you can extend and blend those two things together, the more successful generally businesses tend to be, the more ideas are communicated. And I think this will increase. As I think I did say earlier, that we need to give people a reason to travel into work, to travel into the office. And I think a large part of that can be based in what that experience is, what it means.
Costas is asking, Nick, is generosity of space sustainable?
Well, I guess it depends what you class sustainability as. You might class sustainability as healthy, productive people working, for example. If we mean sustainability by the quantum of material that you use. It can be more generous, lofty spaces, for example, allow more daylight, which reduces your reliance on artificial lighting, as an example. But really, I think sustainable spaces are about those that people are happy to be in for long periods of time. And again, I'm always commenting from sort of a workplace perspective rather than living. I think generosity and volume has its own place in the spaces that we live in too. But yeah, I think if volume and generosity helps produce a more satisfied and productive workforce, I think that then yes, it is sustainable.
And do you think there is enough space for being more generous in the workplace? Yeah.
Oh yes, definitely. Yeah, I'd say we try and push that in our projects, and definitely recognise the value of increased space per person. And it does depend how you achieve that. You know, you can have very dense workspace areas with very, very low density amenity spaces, and the balance can work for people.
Thank you. Nicholas, Ruta is asking, do you think architects have to be creative process facilitators, or a collaboration with actually trained facilitators would be more productive and give architects more time to be creative?
Good question again. How best to answer that? I mean, I think all of our projects, I think we pride ourselves on being able to, we give like equal focus to all stages of the project. So we're equally interested in kind of the very creative process at the beginning of the project, but we see that creative process going through all the different stages, through to how you might procure a project, how you work with contractors on a project, how you actually implement the project. It's all in a creative process, how we set up our organisation, you know, how do we best allow creativity to be its best in the office.
I agree. Creativity runs through a thread, is a thread through everything for us. We're architects, but equally you've got to be, you know, you've got to work on the numbers sometimes, you've got to sometimes be, you know, manager, psychologist, you've got to be many, many hats.
Yeah, and actually that's the thing that we find most fun about it, is you can be having a heated discussion with a contractor about the type of screw that is put through a piece of metal in the wall, but then you're having a high level conversation with the client who's at the start of the project, you know, about the orientation of the building, you know, the dynamics, you know, between, you know, throughout the day is pretty insane actually sometimes.
Tom, you mentioned earlier on that you've been involved in projects outside London as well as this anonymous attendee is asking, do the panelists feel that the spreading out there is a dangerous of urban sprawl and unnecessary impact to the green belt? Can urban design need to get more sophisticated to address a post-COVID world?
I think it's definitely going to change because I think there is capacity for the way that we use cities to evolve and change a little bit now. I think it's the most unusual and extreme experiment we could ever have gone into, because I think, you know, all of us, I'm sure all the rest of the panelists and probably most of the people listening, you know, we've all been in a bit of a kind of rat race in the hamster wheel, and it's go, 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 and we try and fit everything in, and we're always all trying to do so much. And now this process of us all slowing down and reassessing, you know, now our office is back open, but we work in an entirely blended way, you know, a few days from home, a few days in the office is completely free. And I think we now all be able to give ourselves a little bit more freedom, and that opens up the questions of, you know, I wouldn't have considered living outside London as much as I love the countryside, but I think a lot of people ask themselves the same question: that do I need to live in the city the same way that we used to? And that finally that moment has come where I think it becomes far more of a real a real possibility and a real choice. The city will always offer so much in terms of culture. But I think the fact that you need to be here to work. Now, obviously, this is people do lots of different jobs, and there's an awful lot of jobs that cannot be done in a virtual sense. But by the same token, there's a lot that can. I think that will potentially change the city in an interesting way. I don't know whether it's necessarily going to be good, and I don't know whether it's necessarily going to be good for the for outside of the city and in the green belts and in the countryside. Maybe they don't want all of us city dwellers. Moving there, but we'll see. I think there's definitely going to be a lot of flux now.
Nimi, Alan is asking, it was actually a question for everybody, but let's start from Nimi. Climate change, the housing crisis, modern methods of constructions, cradle to cradle design are all on the agenda and shape our design. Does the concept of beauty play any part in your design thinking, and can you define an intrinsic values it may possess, and do your clients, it was a very never-ending question, do your clients ever ask you to design a beautiful building or interiors as part of the brief?
From our experience, no, our clients don't come to us wanting a beautiful building or a beautiful interior. I don't know if it's a given that maybe that's what they're going to get and they don't need to include it. But those are the things that we kind of work with them to achieve. We always want it to be, you know, for it to appeal to their own design aesthetic that they have. So some clients might be really into using timber. Other clients might want something a bit more robust and a bit more hard wearing because they've got lots of kids running around. So I think it depends on what their idea of beautiful is, but we want it to be beautiful and to meet their brief in terms of what they need. I think a lot of things affect our designs, some of which were mentioned, such as climate change, the housing crisis. We're getting a lot of clients who have multi-generationals living. So they've got, you know, big families and they want them all to live together and have their own space and their own privacy, but within one big property. Or potentially they're trying to design for the future and trying to include a time when maybe their elderly parents might come and live with them in the future. So the sort of designs need to meet their needs now, but potentially adapt and be flexible for the future. I think it does affect our designing at the moment. We do try and place quite a big emphasis on climate change and our own moral kind of standing on that. So we try to encourage clients to sort of consider sustainable approaches. And things that might help with climate change, but ultimately it does come down to their brief and their budget. So it's a tricky balance.
Simon, looks like you've got something to add to that.
Me?
The beauty, we're talking beauty, about beauty.
Yeah, beauty is a very subjective beauty, isn't it, right? Because, you know, if we all had the same image in front of us, some of us might think it's more beautiful or less beautiful, and you know, if we had 100 images in front of us, we might pick up different ones of what we determine is the most beautiful, you know, in the eye of the beholder. And I think, going back to one of the earlier questions, some of the difficulties we're finding is clients have access to many, many beautiful images or images. You know, before they point us or talk to us about images, they've probably seen 10,000 images of architectural houses on Instagram, Pinterest, and all these social media platforms. So they're experts now, you know, because they've seen lots of images, and we see lots of images as well. And it's kind of like stitching it together. You know, what is beautiful? You know, we get some people coming to us, like Nick had a client approach us saying they want a house to be exactly like the house in the film Parasite. We want that house. Can you design that for us? So, you know, first of all, we have to determine what they want about that house and why is it beautiful. And we can't give you exactly that house because the site doesn't allow it. But, you know, so it's a very difficult thing. And everyone's different determination of beauty. You need, if you can get under the skin of the client and really understand that for them, that's when you have good projects.
Our anonymous attendee, we always ask very interesting questions, is asking, following the BLM movement and the art, which I suppose is Black Lives Matter movement, and the article in the AJ today stating that architecture is systematically racist, how do you think architects and practices, big and small, can respond to improve the current bias in our profession and increase opportunities for the BAME architect? And how can we design in a way that is more inclusive and encourages social cohesion?
Okay, fairly big question, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, in terms of architecture being systemically racist, I haven't read the article, but I think it's very fair to say that the proportions are not quite what they what we should be. It's not a very balanced profession. And you know, in terms of how that can change, I think is a far, far wider cultural issue, and it's connected to so many problems that we have. The outrageous expense to study architecture, I think is entirely wrong. But you could broaden that, and the expense of studying at university now is not what it was when some of us studied, you know, the very various ages of the panelists. And you know, I think these are real backward steps for social mobility and all sorts of, you know, mobility, and for people to be able to pursue any path that they may want. That path should be open. So I feel like this could turn into an episode of Question Time. And I'm really probably not suitably qualified to answer. But I do think there are significant problems of entry into a profession that sadly is not as it's not as well paid as it really should be. And you know, come from this historical legacy of it being a gentleman's profession, that people would only do it if they were privately wealthy.
Let's ask the lady then, the only lady in the panel. Nimi, what's your thoughts?
We were talking about it in the office, actually. It's quite a big thing for us that we're trying to. I think it's important that the profession needs to address. And I think I felt it being Asian and a woman. We try to promote equality in the office. We're about 60 to 70% women in the office, but it's hard to encourage people into architecture, as Tom was saying. We work with a lot of schools, primary kids, and do workshops. And at the beginning, they sort of ask, right, who's ever considered being an architect? And maybe one person might put their hand up. And after we've done the workshop, you then sort of ask them that, now this is what an architect, you know, this is part of what an architect means. Who would think about doing this as a profession? And, you know, you get a huge amount of kids responding. And I think, and the teachers sort of say that a lot of kids who aren't particularly academic in the conventional sense, you know, good at science, maths, English, they actually really love being physical and working with space and working with scale. But they didn't sort of realize that architecture was like that, or that it was, you know, entailed within the professional. So I guess it's just about making it more public, making it more, you know, making people aware of what we do, and also getting more people that are, you know, from BAME backgrounds out there in the public. It's a very small percentage, but there are a few of us. And I think it's our kind of duty to make sure that we sort of publicize the fact that it can be inclusive if you want it to be. You've got to work hard. The money is an issue, but there's lots of scholarships, there's Stephen Lawrence Trust and various charities that are now working with people trying to get, you know, those that might not go into that kind of profession, for it to become an option. And I think it's a shame that there are few FAME architects, but I think it's a responsibility not just of them, but of the whole profession within it, to really champion it and show it as an opportunity, because I think it's a very big opportunity and one that I think BAME could really, you know, have a good positive influence on and create a good cultural diversity within a profession that needs it.
Nick, you are the one working in the big practices. Have you got anything to add from this perspective?
There are several threads to this issue, aren't there? We're an office of 120 people. We're 50-50 male, female, and that's not by design. That's a happy coincidence. We've got 28 nationalities, I think, so we have people from all over the world. But people from a BAME background are underrepresented at the sort of upper levels of the practice. So I think that we all have a responsibility to educate ourselves and to really recognise the issue in depth. We as a practice support the Stephen Lawrence Trust, and so there are things that we're doing as a practice. But I think education is a big thing. I remember, and I think a lot of the work that we need to do is pre-university for people from a BAME background. I remember when I was at school, I must have been 14 years old or something, 13 years old. I didn't know what architecture was or anything else, actually, for that matter. And I filled out a form with a pencil. I remember you had to stay in the lines. It was very prescriptive. And these forms were run through a computer, and it would pop out what it thought you should do as a career. And mine suggested architecture and law. And I thought I preferred the idea of building. So I went into, and that was my introduction to architecture. It was a sort of a computer questionnaire that analyzed my preferences. And that's where I ended up going. So anyway, I think there's lots more work that we can do in schools and colleges to help people understand what this industry is about. Wasn't until I got to university that I realised what architecture actually is. I sort of pursued this idea of what it was, and it was totally different when I got to university. So anyway, much more work to be done for everybody, I think.
Nicholas, Ruta is asking, what would you all say are the essential skills for future designers and architects?
I think there's so many. What's come across quite clearly today is that so many facets of what the architect does. I think the thing that probably joins them all together actually is working with other people and teamwork and collaboration, really. You know, and I'd say that's kind of the universal thing across all the facets of skills that you do need, actually. That'd be my main thing.
Simon, have you got anything to add to your partner in crime's opinion?
No, not really. I mean, he's exactly right. I don't think architecture's got the exclusivity as well to just working with people. You know, from what I gather, every single job in the world even if you're a computer programmer, you still need some human skills, right? It is about understanding people, managing people, motivating people, being there for people when they recognizing problems, being there for them when they need it. So it's all about that. It's just about being, having human skills is the main one. You can teach yourself other skills, practical skills.
So I'm a bit aware of time. I think we've been talking long enough. So let's try to conclude this with one last question. Tom, maybe you can put an end to this beautiful discussion today and tell us, what do you as an architect look to create an emotional or mindful connection with the occupants of a space?
I think I maybe touched on it earlier on. I think it has to be both. But it's much more than just an emotional or mindful connection, because we always try and, at a very basic level, we're all solving practical problems. I think it's easy to go into this ethereal world of is it an emotional experience, but it must also be a wonderful space to use. And then also we want to create an emotional experience. We try and create as much as possible.
Nimi, can you give us a lady's perspective on this matter?
I don't think it's a lady's perspective per se, but yeah, I think it inevitably we do always have an emotional and mindful connection with our clients and the users of the space. I think that's part of what makes a good architect, that if you can kind of imagine who you're designing for completely, then you will produce a really good piece of architecture. And it's all about engagement for us, that in order to understand them, we need to engage with them and make them involved in the process.
Okay, I think this is the end of today's session. So thank you very much to our amazing panelists. It was all very interesting, and to hear your thoughts on what we discussed today. We are going to be back at the end of August. It's another partnership with Page Park Architects in Glasgow, and we will be talking about creating a natural learning environment with Karen Nugent, who's the head of creative workspace at Page and Park. So we will release more information about this in the next week or so. Thank you very much to everybody for attending today, and obviously again our panelists and our sponsor Domus Tiles. You all have a good day, and I'll see you next month. Thank you very much.